Welcome back. Let's now turn back to tech. If you're old enough and cast your mind back a couple of decades, you probably wouldn't have predicted e-readers, touchscreens, computers, or video teleconferencing. Well, our Middle East editor, Elliot Gotkin, knows a man who did. Of course, he's too young to remember it himself. He now joins us from the Tel Aviv Stock Exchange with the very latest. Elliot.
You're very kind and a very good liar, Francine. Yes, I have with me the co-founder of the MIT Media Lab and one laptop per child, among many, many other things that would take me too long to go into right now. But he is Professor Nicholas Negroponte, and he joins me now. Thanks very much for coming here. What actually brings you to Israel right now?
Well, MIT has an enterprise forum, and this is the 20th anniversary of the one in Israel, so I have come for that occasion.
And this is to kind of provide just pearls of wisdom to young entrepreneurs and the
Well, also to represent MIT and the full support it's giving not only the enterprise forum, but the people in Israel who've been entrepreneurs.
Okay, well, as I say, there are, of course, many strings to your bow, perhaps one laptop per child, one of the things you're most well known for. How is that actually going? Because we don't see as much of a fuss about it nowadays as perhaps we used to.
Well, that's a sign of success. It's a fuss when people are fighting against it. I'm no longer directly involved, but there are about 3 million of them in exactly the places you want them. And when we did it 7 or 8 years ago, it was at the time considered totally crazy. Today, nobody argues against it. The only discussion that people have is, can you afford it? Is one laptop per child affordable?
But are those goals, I mean, are they fulfilled? Are we halfway there? Where are we?
It depends on the country. Some countries, one in particular, Uruguay, did every single child in the country and did that 4 years ago, and includes all the cohorts. So every child from the age of 5 to 18 has a connected laptop, Wi-Fi at school, connectivity at home. Peru has about 1 million. Ethiopia is going in that direction. It depends which country and which head of state and the momentum, really.
Technology obviously advances at a rapid pace. Mm-hmm. I mean, would it now be more appropriate to have one tablet per child, a smartphone, a Google Glass per child? I mean,
the technology changes, and the tablet versus the laptop's an interesting transition. There's a certain thing about screen size, which has to do with the size of your hands, if you're touching the screen, the size of reading. So yes, kids can do things on phones, but ideally you want a tablet or a laptop. And so it's, at this point, somewhat technology agnostic. As long as you're connected and as long as you have powerful enough machine, as long as it's yours, it's part of your daily life.
One laptop per child, an extremely ambitious aim. Mm-hmm. What's next for you?
Well, with the experience of having done that, and I'm looking at what worked, what didn't work, we started an experiment a few years ago where we dropped off tablets in villages with no literacy, but with no instructions and no people, just left the tablets to see if the children on their own would sort of figure out what's inside, sort of start. Within 5 days, they were using 50 apps per child. Within 2 weeks, they were singing ABC songs, and within 6 months, they hacked Android. So when we see that, and in this case, Ethiopian villages that didn't have words in the village, it's not, there was nobody who was literate, there was no electricity, there was no telephone connection, and yet the children were able to go that far on their own. So what we're trying to do now is leverage that and see if we can create a technology that when dropped into villages like that basically creates literacy. In a richer definition of literacy than just reading, but reading's a pretty important piece.
Okay, now, you're also credited with, for example, predicting the likes of e-readers and touchscreen computers and the like. What are you now seeing in the next 10, 20, 50 years if you look into your quite well-respected crystal ball?
Well, just to review, the predictions at the time that I made them were extrapolations. They were things we were doing. So we weren't sitting there predicting, just really extrapolating. Today, it's probably not in the telecommunications computer space. It's probably more in where biotech and silicon and sort of in general the biotech side of the world. I mean, if I had to look forward 20 years, you should be able to swallow a pill and know English after you've done that. I mean, there should be
swallow a pill and be able to speak English.
Yes, that's the kind of thing that 20 years from now, one of us can figure out whether that happened. It'll probably be you.
Okay, well, on that very flattering note, yes. I think you also predicted the end of nationalism at some point down the line.
But I hope that'll happen too. But this is not the country to talk about that in.
This would be the ideal country, perhaps. Yeah. But anyway, Professor Nicholas Negroponte, thanks very much for joining me today on the 20th anniversary of the MIT Enterprise Forum taking place here in Israel. For now, back to you, Guy.
Elliot, incredibly interesting interview, incredibly interesting guy. Ask him if he's ever in London, if he can stop by the studios, and we'd love to carry on the conversation. Elliot Godkin, looking into the future.